Here we are. Lesson. Balaam cannot curse Israel. And I've kind of drew a map here. And we'll find out that Balaam is the guy who is Moab, the king of Moab, wants Balaam to curse Israel, who is encamped here. And they're encamped here, and their encampment, there's, you know, 1.5 to 2 million people camped around this city here, and I'll find that as we go through the lesson. And so Balaam is contracted by Moab to curse Israel, and Balak is the king of Moab, and he wants Balaam. It's the names are so similar, Balak and Balaam, son of Beor and son of, you know, it's like same, it's different entirely, but they have the same sounding names. And so here we have Jerusalem, we have Jericho, the Dead Sea, and this is a road. It's very important later on that goes up to the east, and we'll talk about that hopefully as we go on. In this lesson, we encounter one of the more intriguing, there we go, figures of the Old Testament named Balaam. Balaam was, he was a prophet for hire. So was he a prophet of God? Was he a false prophet? Well, the New Testament says that they don't rank him very high. In fact, he ends up being killed by the Israelites. But he does have a gift or does have an insight into some prophetic messages. But in the lesson, we find that God spoke to him and tells him what he's supposed to say. And, of course, the king, Balak of Moab, he doesn't like this because he's paying Balaam to curse Israel. And whenever the Moabites are looking down off of these mountains here and seeing the children of Israel, they're, you know, like we said, there's close to 2 million people there, if not more. And Moab is frightened that these Israelites are going to come and wipe them out. So he wants Balaam to come and curse them. So that's what our lesson is about today, why it didn't happen and kind of what happens, how that this whole lesson unfolds. So in Numbers chapter 22, verses 1 to 6, and the children of Israel set forth and pitched in the plains of Moab on this side of the Jordan of Jericho. And Balak, the son of Zippor, so Balak, the king, he is the son of Zippor, saw all that Israel had done to the Amorites. So Israel had fought a couple of battles before they came to this camping here, and the plains of Jordan. Is that what it said? Pitched their tent in the plains of Moab. So Moab and the plains of Moab. So they're right next door to Moab. And so these are plains, yeah. So if you can put 2 million people in there, it's a pretty big it's a pretty big section. It's a big place in history. And so the king is looking at all these people in the, you know, there's 2 million people here in this city, surrounded the city, and in the you want to look it up in on the internet, the go to Expedition Bible, and it is the title of the segment is The Star Prophecy, and Expedition Bible Star Prophecy, and he has these overview, you know, he has his drone over these cities and times, where this here is just a top of a mountain, and this Mount Peor is actually a city that is being excavated, and this city down here, which I'll get to, it's completely excavated. So it's a tell where they've built on top of it. So so this city here is, they know the location because it's across from Jericho. And then when Balak, excuse me, when Balaam tries to curse Israel, he has to be at this place to do so, and that location is still a city. And, well, I don't know if it's still a city, but there are road markers. These are, this little line through here, these are Roman roads that connected the east, you know, up into Syria and, you know, up into what we'd have Iran, Iraq, and all those stay up in that area. And this goes on down to Africa. This is the plain of Moab, and this is where 2 million people of Israel are camped. And they are camped according to tribe. So there's not just a massive group of people. They are camped according to tribe, kind of like separation between each of the tribes. And the place where they offer sacrifice, it's a movable tent. And that is in the center, and all these 12 tribes are surrounding that. And this is Mount Peor, where he makes the final declaration about Israel. But he can't curse them because God says you can't do that. And Moab was distressed because of the children of Israel. And Moab said unto the elders of Midian, now shall this company lick up all the that are around about us, as an ox licketh up grass in the field. So they're afraid that Israel's just going to wipe them out like a cow eating grass. They're just going to wipe them out. And Balak, the son of Zippor, the king of the Moabites, he sent a messenger therefore unto Balaam, the son of Beor. Okay, so you've got Balak, and you've got Balaam. You've got Balak, the son of Zippor, and you've got Balaam, the son of Beor. Okay, you know, that's why I always got confused with reading this, but I got it down pat now. Since I looked at this video, it's kind of easier to put it together. There is a people come up from Egypt. Behold, they cover the face of the earth, and they abide over against me. So they cover, you know, they're just, you know, millions of people, and they are right next to our border, and I know they're just going to conquer us. So he's saying to Balaam, come now, therefore, I pray thee, curse me this people, for they are too mighty for me. Peradventure I shall prevail, that we may smite them, and that I may drive them out of the land, for I wot that he whom thou blessed is blessed, and whom thou cursed is cursed. So Balak recognizes that Balaam has this spiritual insider, spiritual authority, that whom he curses is cursed, and whom he blessed is blessed. And so in the ancient world, their superstitions, their diviners, their readers of liver, cattle liver, that's later, they're able to foretell the future, okay? So we'll go on. And he took up his parable and said, Balak, the king of Moab, hath brought me from Aram out of this mountain of the east, saying, come, curse me, Jacob, and come, defy Israel. And this is how that Balaam responds to Balak. He says, how shall I curse whom God hath not cursed? And how shall I defy whom the Lord hath not defied? So I like this in the sense that we can apply it to our own life. You know, blessings are upon the children of God. Doesn't matter who, you know, I don't know, it was a few years ago, there was a lot of things, you know, people were setting curses on Christians because of their belief in Christ and all that stuff. Well, Balaam is the one, he's telling Balak that you can't curse what God has blessed. End of story. You can't curse what God has blessed. So you are blessed by God, and, you know, the curse of whomever is like water on a duck's back. It just it just goes away. It doesn't even get that close to get the duck wet. So whom God has blessed, Satan cannot curse. you know, need to remember that. People think they, well, I did this wrong. It doesn't matter. If you're forgiven, that curse, that bondage of sin is broken. The chains of sin are broken. So there's no way that works. For whom For from the top of the rock I see him, and from the hills I behold him. Lo, the people shall dwell alone and shall not be reckoned among the nations. Who can count the dust of Jacob and the number of the fourth part of Israel? So what happens is from this first mountain here, Balak brings Balaam to this first mountain. And he is looking over this area, but he can't see the whole tribe. So he's saying, I can't curse what God has blessed. So Balak moves to the second mountain, which is Pisgah, which will come a little later. So where he's at now, he's at this mountain, and there's a name for it. I don't have it here. But it is a literal mountain in Israel, in Jordan. And if you look that up on the video, you'll see it. He goes through this whole thing on Expedition Bible. Let me die the death of the righteous, and let my last end be like his. So Balaam is saying, I want to be like the children of Israel. I can't curse them. You can't curse what God has blessed. And he says, if I die, I want to die like the Israelites, because they are blessed by God. And Balak said unto Balaam, what hast thou done unto me? So Balaam's paid him all this money to come and curse Israel. And so he says, what have you done to me? You've blessed them, and I didn't pay you to bless them. I paid you to curse them. So I took thee to curse mine enemies, and behold, thou hast blessed them altogether. And he answered and said, must I not take heed to speak that which the Lord hath put in my mouth? So Balaam is capable of hearing from God. God speaks to him, you know. He's set out to curse Israel, and God won't let him. He says, every time when he opens his mouth, he can't curse. Because God forbid him to do it, and he can't curse them. And Balak said unto him, come, I pray thee, with me to another place. Okay, so if you can't curse the Israelites from here, let's move over here. Let's go to Pisgah. Now, this is the mountain where Moses looked over the promised land, and he died in this valley between Mount Peor and Pisgah. And to this day, it's known as the Valley of Moses. So it's in here that Moses dies. But this happens after, I guess. It happens after, before Moses dies, okay? Then Moses is still the leadership, and the leadership hasn't transitioned to Joshua. Balaam is out at Mount Pisgah, and it's there. So let's change places, and maybe you'll have a different impression. Okay, you can't curse God from where you were. So let's move over here. I pray thee with me to go to another place from whence thou mayest see them. So the problem was you couldn't see the whole congregation. You couldn't see all of them. So let's go to a place where you can see more of the children of Israel. You can only see part of the camp. And curse unto the othermost part of them, and shalt not. Okay, let me go back and read this. I should have printed this out in another translation. And with me to another place from whence thou mayest see them. Thou shalt see but the uttermost part of them, and shalt not see them all, and curse them from hence. So I'm going to another place, and you're not going to see the whole camp, but you're going to see more of them. So I want you to go over to this place and curse them. And he brought him to the field of Ziphron, to the top of Pisgah, and built 7 altars and offered a bullock and a ram on every altar. And said unto Balak, stand here by the burnt offerings while I meet the Lord yonder. Balak, the king, puts up 7 altars. He offers 7 bulls and 7 rams for sacrifices so that Balaam can hear from God. Okay. He wants to hear from, you know, Balak the king wants Balaam to hear from God. He's the prophet. So they have 7 sacrifices. And he said unto him, Balak, stand here by the burnt offerings while I meet the Lord yonder. And the Lord met Balaam and put a word in his mouth and said, go again unto Balak and say this. And when he came to him, behold, he stood by his burnt offerings and the prince of Moab with him. And Balak said unto him, what hath the Lord spoken? Now, one of the things that's not in here but was brought out in this other video, that often he is a, I think it's even in this lesson, he's a diviner of livers. There's a special name for it. So he took the livers of these 7 bulls and 7 rams, and that they were laid out before him, and he was to, whatever, look at them and decide what the livers were telling him, okay? But then he goes over to talk to God. And when he goes over and talked to God, verse 18, and he took up his parable and said, rise up, Balak, and hear. So Balaam is talking to the king. And hear, hearken unto me, thou son of Zippor. God is not a man. This is another important message. We were talking downstairs that there was this audio played of an individual who was a Christian, talking about this service where the lady was saying that God is evolving and going on that whole part, that man is evolving, God is evolving. You know, the scripture says God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Well, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God is not a man. Okay? Often mankind has created God in their own image. No, God created us in his image and in his likeness. And so there is a part of us that is to be connected with God. And, you know, actually all of us is to be connected with God. But we can't make God like us. God wants to make us like him. So that we're in this whole process. So Balaam says, God is not a man that he should lie. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What God promised to Abraham and to Isaac and to Jacob, he will fulfill today. Because God cannot lie. He does not change his mind. And shall he not do it? You know, he doesn't repent, and hath he said, and what he has said he shall do. And hath he spoken, and shall he not make it good? So when we talk about the promises of God, that God has promised never to leave us nor forsake us, shall God not make that good? So Balaam is declaring the truth about God, and you know, it's God who has revealed this to him. Balaam hasn't come up on his own. By reading livers, he hasn't come up with this. God spoke to him. And behold, I have received commandment to bless. So he was supposed to curse, but he can't. I have received a command to bless, and he hath blessed, and I cannot receive it. He hath not beheld iniquity in Jacob, neither hath he seen perverseness in Israel. The Lord his God is with him, and the shout of a king is among them. So we got this going on, that the shouts of a king, well, we know that through Christ, that the lineage is coming through Jesus, and that he is the King of kings and Lord of lords. And so Balaam, here, as it were, hears this shout of a king from the children of Israel. And not only that, in this tabernacle of Israel, that the presence of God is hovering over it. It's like this cloud over the tent of the tabernacle. And so Balaam is looking at this and he's saying, I can't curse that, because God has already told him, don't curse this. You can't curse this. Surely there is no enchantment against Jacob. That's what Balaam is saying to Balak. There is no enchantment against him, neither is there any divination against Israel. According to this time it shall be said of Jacob and of Israel, what hath God wrought? Meaning, what God has put in place, God will fulfill. So, what God has said to the nation of Israel, because they know the history coming out of Egypt, they know the difficulties they've gone through, they know the victories that they've received, and they are now in this valley, and they're afraid. Moab's afraid they're going to come and attack them, but that's not the direction God is taking them. He's taking them across the Jordan River over to Jericho, because that's their promised land. Right. Behold, the people shall rise up as a great lion, the lion of the tribe of Judah, and lift up himself as a young lion, and he shall not lie down until he eateth the prey and drinketh the blood of the slain. So he's saying, nobody's going to be able to curse these people, and no one's going to be able to take away what God has given to them. And so he reckons him to a young lion that is going to attack. And then in chapter 24, verse 1, and when Balaam saw that it pleased the Lord to bless Israel, he went not as other times to seek for enchantments. So before, he would go and look for enchantments, you know, like he would, you know, look at the livers of these animals, and he would look at this, and he would look for ways to curse Israel, and then God would interrupt him and say, you can't curse Israel. Get away from them livers. They're not going to tell you anything. But he set his face towards the wilderness. So Balaam lifts up his eyes and he looks towards the wilderness. He looks in the opposite direction. All right? He looks in the opposite direction and he lifts up his eyes and he saw Israel abiding in his tents according to their tribes. Excuse me. He looked this way. He looked that way. Sorry about that. East and west, wilderness, up and down. Anyhow, he looks from Pisgah, he looks over here to the Israelites, and he sees them in their camp. And the Spirit of God came upon him, and he took up his parable and said, Balaam, son of Beor, hath said, and the man whose eyes are open hath said, he hath said which heard the words of God and saw the vision of the Almighty, falling into a trance, but having his eyes open. So Balaam sees the campment, sees all of the people divided in their groups, and he goes in, he has a trance, but he's still awake. And he goes on to say, and having his eyes open. Now, in Numbers 24, verse 5, let's continue. How godly are thy tents, how goodly are thy tents. So he's trying to curse them, and he says, how goodly are your tents. Oh, excuse me. They've now moved from Pisgah to Mount Peor, which is right here. And so this is important, this little Mount Peor. And as I said, it's a excavation that they've dug. And, oh, excuse me. There is this Roman road. What the Romans did was they put mile markers up. They put pillars made of stone, and they put pillars on these roads, which were mile markers. And these mile markers are still there in this area. Some of them they have removed and put in a museum, but some are still there because they're broken. And so this Roman road goes right through this Mount Peor right by where Balaam, is to prophesy against Israel. Okay. And so he begins by saying, as he's looking at the tents of the Israelites, he's saying, "How goodly are thy tents, O Jacob, and thy tabernacles, O Israel. As the valleys are, they spread forth, as gardens by the riverside, as the trees of Ligen line, aloes, which the Lord hath planted, and as cedar trees beside the waters." So he's making this analogy between about trees and things that are growing, that are sturdy, and that are in place. "He shall pour the water out of the buckets, and his seed shall be in many waters, and his king shall be higher than the Agag, and his kingdom shall be exalted." So, talking about Israel. Kingdom be exalted, they're mighty, they're strong. "And God brought him forth out of Egypt. He hath, as it were, the strength of a unicorn. He shall eat up the nations, his enemies, and shall break their bones, and pierce them through with his arrows. He lay as a lion, as a great lion. Who shall stir him up?" So these are all the blessings of that Balaam is talking about. You can't go against these people. They're like a lion. They're crouched like a lion. They're going to devour you. You go sneaking into their camp, they're going to eat you up. Then he says, "Blessed is he that blesseth thee, and cursed is he that curseth thee." So when we talk about how that those who curse Israel are cursed, those who bless Israel are blessed. Balaam spoke this under the inspiration of God, whom he is being paid by Balak to curse. And Balaam is saying, you can't curse what God has blessed. Boom. And if you curse what God has blessed, you'll be cursed. That's what it says. "I am the same yesterday, today, and forever." This promised blessing, even though it came through Balaam, who is this questionable seer, it is the truth of God, because he goes into this trance, as it were, with his eyes open, and he's speaking these things, okay? And Balaam, what is it, verse 12? "And Balaam said unto Balak, Spake I not also to thy messengers which thou sent me unto me, saying, If Balak would give me his house full of silver and gold, I cannot go beyond the commandment of the Lord. If he paid me a whole house full of gold, I can't go against what God has said. I cannot go behind the commandment of the Lord. Excuse me, beyond. I cannot go beyond the commandment of the Lord to do either good or bad of mine own mind, but what the Lord said, that will I speak." Okay? Now there's one more verse that I want to go to. It's Numbers 24:17, which is not in our lesson. Numbers 24:17 says, Balaam speaking again. "I see him," now he's looking from Mount Peor onto the camp. "I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near." Okay? What he's saying is, it's a foretelling of Jesus. "I see him, but he's not now. I behold him, but he's not near. A star will come out of Jacob." Star? Star of Bethlehem? What is the star? What is Israel's symbol? A star. "A star will come out of Jacob. A scepter will rise out of Israel." Scepter means power and king. Okay? So he is the king. Here he is foretelling the coming of Jesus. And what is so impressive is, who do we have coming from the east at the birth of Christ, or when he's 2 years old? We generally see there are three of them. The wise men, all right. The wise men come from the east. Where do they come? They come down the Roman road and right by Mount Peor, where Balaam prophesies about the star. Isn't that neat? They come right by where Balaam is saying, and they walk right through where the camp was. They go across the river to Jericho and to Jerusalem and then to Bethlehem. And Balaam is prophesying about the star coming in Israel, a king who will have the scepter. And so it's really, this road is—it still can be seen. I mean, it's not anything like it was, of course, but the road can still be seen where the people had traveled, because it was a well-known road. And so it's just so interesting that here at this Mount Peor, he prophesies about the star and the scepter, and it's that very road that the wise men, there's probably more than three, but the wise men make their journey right by where the prophetic message was given, to go right by the camp of Israel over to Bethlehem and over to Israel and to Jerusalem, where they ask the king, where is he that is born king of the Jews? What is the sign of the king? A star and a scepter. The guy that on Expedition Bible, he does a better job. But I just think that's quite interesting, you know, that here's this guy being paid to curse Israel, and God says, "Nah, you're not going to do it." So people who are against Israel today, and, you know, God says, "You're not going to do it. You can speak all you want, but it's not going to come to anything, because God is going to take care of Israel. He has made that promise from all these thousands of years ago. He's made that promise that you're not, this is my covenant people. And if you think you can come against them and curse them, you yourself will receive the curse. Those who bless Israel will be blessed. Why? Because God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And this is his word. And this is what he has promised. And it shall come to pass even as he has said." Amen. So Balaam launched into his final set of blessings. And after this final prophetic blessing for Israel, Balaam and the king rose and went their separate ways. Imagine that. Balaam got his money. I don't know if he got his money or not. But they both got up and went their separate ways. The king Balak of Moab, he's scared to death that the children of Israel are going to come and conquer him. But, you know, to no avail, because Joshua is going to take them across the river, and they're going to go into, circle Jericho and take Jericho. Amen? Amen. One other thing I've been talking about how that at Shiloh, there was the first temple at Shiloh. Well, the children of Israel came over, and they circled and they conquered Jericho, and then they went up to Ai, which is just a small city up here, and of course they lost the battle. But here in this region here is Shiloh, and that's where they built the first temple or the tabernacle, and for 400 years this is where they worshiped. And in this dig, that's where they found the silver tablet with ancient Hebrew writing on, right here. So all that's right in the same region. But this is many years after, not a whole lot of years, but a couple of years later. All right, any questions? Wasn't that interesting? Yeah, and to think that, well, in our lesson, they saw how God had blessed Israel, and blessed Israel, and you'll be blessed, but the commentator didn't pick up on this star blessing. You know, but that just goes to show that the more we read of the scriptures, the more we find there is to know, and it's been right under our nose. It's right under his nose, the commentator, but he stops before he gets there because he doesn't, you know, in his eyes or whomever, they don't particularly see it. But it's there. And that's the truth. That's the thing about God's word. It continues to be an ongoing revelation. It is not God evolving. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. It's us who are continuing to grow in our knowledge and our understanding of Scripture. Amen? Jesus, we thank you for being the star of Bethlehem. And we thank you for your blessings on our life, and we thank you for our knowledge of your word and how that it just continues to unfold before us. We ask you to guide us. God, strengthen us. Let your presence always go with us and before us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.